So this is NRI Samai, live from Los Angeles. We'll be having Dr. Jayaprakash Narayan from Lok Satta Party, National President, and Suruvaram Sudhakar Reddy Garu, General Secretary of Communist Party of India, CPI, a very old political party. It started off in 1925, so almost 87 years old political party, Communist Party of India. We'll be having them live in a few minutes. And recently, Dr. Jayaprakash Narayan has welcomed the newly elected CPI General Secretary Suruvaram Sudhakar Reddy Garu's support for the replacement of first past the post electoral system by a proportional representation system. That's what they call in Telugu as Damasha Paddhati. So also in the media statement, Dr. Jayaprakash Narayan said that the first past the post system has led to vote buying and rise of money power to garner marginal vote for capturing as many seats as possible. So this has resulted in unbridled corruption and generation of black money on a large scale. So in such a system, the best and the brightest are unable to play a key role through ethical politics and principles. And so politics without principles and ethics has brought in a grave political crisis across India right now, and that is a phenomenon we are seeing. So Dr. Jayaprakash Narayan has welcomed CPI General Secretary Suruvaram Sudhakar Reddy Garu, a man with impeccable record, who has been very clean in politics. Both politicians, Dr. Jayaprakash Narayan and Suruvaram Sudhakar Reddy Garu, they have a clean track record in politics, and it's good to see both these parties coming together to fight for key electoral reforms. So it's time that all political parties introspected and arrive at a consensus to change the electoral system. And that's what Dr. Jayaprakash Narayan and Suruvaram Sudhakar Reddy Garu have been talking about in the recent past. So we'll get both of them, Dr. JP and Suruvaram Sudhakar Reddy Garu, to talk more about this. And if you have any questions related to Lok Satta Party or CPI Party, please do dial in to our studio. In United States, it is 323-410-0162. And anywhere else in the world, please do Skype us on NRS Samai, and we will pick your question, and you can talk live on air with Dr. JP or Suruvaram Sudhakar Reddy Garu. So we'll be patching both the leaders in a couple of minutes. So do stay tuned, my friends. In the meantime, listen to this wonderful song.
Hi, friends. This is Sri Hari. I will be the host for today's show. We have two extraordinary gentlemen with us right now. We have Suruvaram Sudhakar Reddy Garu. He is the General Secretary of CPI. And Dr. JP Garu, he is the President of Lok Satta Party. And thank you to Srikant, who gave an excellent background about today's show. And we will start right away. First of all, thank you very much to Suruvaram Sudhakar Garu. Please, you are welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Dr. JP Garu, thank you very much for joining us. We welcome you to the show as well.
Thank you. My pleasure, Sri Garu.
Sir, we will...
Namaskaram, JP Garu.
Namaskaram. So, we are going to talk about Delhi, Hyderabad.
Hello.
ఎక్కడి నుంచి మాట్లాడుతున్నారు అని అడుగుతున్నారు.
జయప్రకాష్ గారు, నేను ఢిల్లీ నుంచి మాట్లాడుతున్నాను.
ఢిల్లీ నుంచి మాట్లాడుతారా? నైస్ మీటింగ్ యూ ఆన్ ది షో సుధాకర్ రెడ్డి గారు.
థ్యాంక్ యూ వెరీ మచ్. బాగున్నారు కదా?
ఓ ఫైన్, థ్యాంక్ యూ. శ్రీహర్ గారు, ప్లీజ్ గో ఆన్.
సార్, జేపీ గారు, మీరు కొంచెం గట్టిగా మాట్లాడాల్సి అనుకుంటా సార్. మీ వాయిస్ కొంచెం తక్కువలో ఉంది.
Oh, okay, I'll try. Is this better,
sir,
now?
Yes, sir. So we have listeners actually from across the world, and most of our listeners are across India. So I would like to continue the show in English. I hope it's okay with you both.
Perfect.
Yes.
Okay, sir. I have to say that first we contacted Sudhakar Garu, and then we wanted to do a show with him. Then I called him back and I said, Sudhakar Garu, we would like to add JP Garu also. Do you mind? He was really happy and he said, you know what, we might have some policy, you know, disagreements, but I really respect JP Garu and I would like to have him on the show as well. So I have to thank you both for agreeing to come together and we are honored to have you both on the show. Excellent, sir. So we gave the background about the show to our listeners before you both joined, and I would like to briefly tell you the structure of today's show. So this is an online radio, which means anybody with internet anywhere in the world will listen live. This is broadcast live on the internet. And once it is completed, we put all our shows recorded on youtube.com/NRISMI. So anybody can go there and listen to the recording if they missed the live show. So as far as today's show, we have some questions, mostly on political and social issues in India, and we will focus some of the questions on Andhra Pradesh also. Then our audience can actually call into the studio, and they can ask their questions directly. Or we also have a website, nrisami.com, and we have a chat, live chat. They also post their questions there. So I will call out their name and I will ask their question. So, sir, can we start? You okay with the format?
Yes, please go ahead.
Okay, sir. So I'll start with my own question. I would like to start with Suravaram Sudhakar Garu. Sir, in our country right now, it looks like government is facing a lot of embarrassment, you know, week after week. You know, a lot of they're not winning in the courts, or they're not they are facing failures in the parliament. So, from your like 2G scam or Lokpal or several other things, one after other, we have been seeing for the last 6 months at least. So, do you think the government can refocus and gain public confidence from here on? Or where do you see this going?
Somehow I feel that the government is really not honest in bringing a strong Lokpal bill. There is a difference of opinion what should be a strong Lokpal bill. The proposals by Anna Hazare are not acceptable to most of us. They wanted to create a new superstructure which will control the parliament, executive, judiciary, everything. We want judiciary should be kept out and that judiciary accountability bill should be there. Then the question of a strong Lokpal bill will be successful only if CBI has got some sort of autonomy. It should not be utilized as an instrument in the hands of the ruling party to threaten and victimize the political opponents as it is happening today. CBI has got some credibility, but CBI has to work under the Home Ministry. They have got lots of limitations and all that. And I do agree with Dr. J. Prakash Narayan's proposal that there should be a fear that if the corrupted money should be totally confiscated, then there will be a second thought while taking the corruption. If only a prolonged inquiry and a prolonged court litigation, ultimately most of them will get released. In many cases, the government will not give the permission for inquiry on the officers. Many political people also get escaped. This type of thing naturally will not create a confidence. For example, now on the Adarsh Housing Cooperative Society scam in Mumbai, it is found that the former Chief Minister Ashok Chavan was responsible. Another Chief Minister, Vasant Rao, also is responsible. One Chief Minister is asked to resign. But there are no cases, no arrests, no charge sheet. Some small fries in the department are getting arrested. How the people will get confidence that this government has really got any sincerity in controlling the corruption and the lockdown will be useful. So I don't think this government, to save its skin, to save its leaders, is absolutely not interested to bring a strong, powerful lockdown bill, which can be an instrument to control the corruption to a large extent.
Okay, excellent, sir. I would like to ask Dr. JP one question. In the current state of affairs, it looks like a lot of people, like middle class and poor people, they don't trust the police or the courts. Even when they are victims, they don't go and report their cases. And on the other side, you see that when popular leaders get inquiries on them, or they have cases filed on them, then there are a lot of people, they don't trust the CBI or the courts are doing a good job. So what needs to be done for the legal system to gain public confidence again?
Srihari Garu, as you said, there is undoubtedly a lot of trust deficit in the country right now. The reason why Anna Hazare and his colleagues and many of the civil society groups and the media, they got so much traction, is that there is an enormous amount of anger and mistrust thanks to 2G spectrum, other scam in Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka, the mining scam, and many, many other things. It's really a cumulative impact of all this. But my appeal to all thinking Indians is, while there is a reason why we should all be angry, lashing out in a very angry manner, in a very reckless manner, will not help us. Ultimately, we have a system to operate. We have to deal with the political parties, with the parliament, with the leaders, many of whom care deeply about the country and its future. And we have to find a sensible answer. Because, painting everybody by the same brush and thinking that all politics is bad is actually detrimental to the political process and democracy. Unfortunately, in recent months, somewhere along the line, we lost a sense of purpose, and it's all about lashing out at each other. Mahatma Gandhi once said, the best way and the quickest way of getting justice is rendering justice to your opponent, rendering justice to the other party. We are forgetting that. When even an adversary is saying something sensible, if you don't acknowledge it and say, all right, let's build on that, we always have a fighting match, a slanging match without any outcome. There is no reason to despair that corruption cannot be controlled in India. I have every reason to believe that Indian people are no worse than people elsewhere. Other countries went through a similar phase of corruption, failure of institutions, but those countries, they found the leadership and the sagacity and the wisdom and quality public discourse and sensible media intervention and civil society pressure to bring about systematic change, step by step. What we require now, as Sudhakar Reddy Garu said rightly, is a strong and independent ombudsman. Lokpal has become merely a symbol. It's not enough. That's just a symbolic issue now around which all the anti-corruption fight is waged. Therefore, Lokpal and Lokayuktas at the state level, local ombudsman at the local level, in the local government level, property confiscation law, a strong property confiscation law, independent investigation, independent prosecution, special courts. But all these are not sufficient. We also have to bring in competition. That's why Lok Sabha has gone to the Supreme Court asking for cancellation of the 2G licenses, because unless the people who corrupted the system, they lose out, they do not benefit from the proceeds of corruption, corruption will continue. Mere putting in jail is not a sufficient punishment. Supreme Court happily agreed with this argument, and they cancelled 122 licenses. And recently, the government of India wanted to again file a review petition to the president, but mercifully, I think the wiser counsels prevailed, and therefore they withdrew the petition. So we have to bring in competition. We also have to bring in other instruments, like, for instance, Windfall Profits Tax Act. You know, if somebody got undue profit, even if there is no malfeasance or corruption, but they profited from the natural resources, not by their innovation, not through competition, but because of monopoly over natural resources. In Britain, what they did was, they got back a lot of the profits to the government by Windfall Profit Tax Act, because these profits are windfall profits, not competitive profits. Similarly, something like the U.S. Mechanism False Claims Act, whereby the state exchequer, the government, has lost money on account of a tender, contract, bidding, or whatever, then anybody can file a claim before a court, and if it is proved, then a penalty will be imposed, and the people who file the claim and successfully prosecuted the case, they will get a part of this penalty. So we have many innovative instruments. I'm sure India will move in that direction. One happy thing, after all this, is the parliamentary committee did come out with a reasonable draft. It's not a perfect draft, but it's a reasonable draft. We could build upon that. I think even now, if the two big concerns, the CBI's autonomy and not forcing the states to have the same model. Well, we require definitely anti-corruption institutions in the states. We cannot force them to have the same model. Therefore, having a mechanism by which the states will definitely have it, nevertheless, their own model, which is acceptable. If those two big issues are set right, I'm sure the parliament will approve this law, and that will be a good starting point in our fight against corruption. Shri Garu.
Okay. Excellent, sir. We have a caller, is Rao from Austin, United States. Rao Garu, are you on the call?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Please be very specific and ask your question. Thank you.
Namaskaram, JP Garu. మీరు చాలాసార్లు హైదరాబాద్ పోలీస్ యాక్షన్లో కేవలం 5 చనిపోయినారు అని చెప్పి చెప్తూ వచ్చారు. అది బహుశా రాంగ్ ఏమో అనిపిస్తోంది మీ ఇన్ఫర్మేషన్. ఎందుకంటే కనీసం కొన్ని 100 చనిపోయినారు అని చెప్పేసి అఫీషియల్ ఇన్ఫర్మేషన్ వెబ్లో అవైలబుల్గా ఉంది. దీని మీద మీరు ఏమైనా కామెంట్ చేస్తారా?
The information that I have is that in the actual police action, there was hardly any resort to violence or firing. Only 5 people died. While in the events leading up to police action, Sudhakar Reddy Garu would know very well that the Communist Party was in the forefront of the struggle against the Nizam in those days. And Najakar inflicted a lot of suffering on the ordinary people and the peasants. There was a lot of violence and death and bloodshed during that time. But in the actual police action, if you recall, it was just a matter of a few hours. Practically in 72 to 120 hours, it was all over, and only 5 people died. But it's a matter of verification, and if historically it is proved that there are more fatalities because of police action, we can always rectify that. But this is the information that I have.
Okay, thank you, sir. So next question I would like to ask is to the Sudhakar Garu. Sudhakar Garu, so one of, actually a lot of folks are asking, this is more specific to the CPI and Marxism. They are saying overall Marxism across the world is kind of losing the ground, and then how would you bring it back? This is a similar question was asked by Sridhar from United Kingdom. Please go ahead, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. So the question was, the Marxism is losing the ground, and people are not following as much as they used to. So how would you, how would CPI and CPM come back into the more into the public and get maybe more votes and more representation?
It is true, after the collapse of Soviet Union in the socialist camp in 1990s, the countries where socialism was a living example, that disappeared, and a type of atmosphere has been created that Marxism is gone. But as a matter of fact, in the last few years, the crisis in the capitalist society in the whole of Europe, in the United States of America, this shows that what Marx has predicted, what the communists were predicting all these years, that capitalism is getting into much deeper crisis. And in the fight between capitalism and socialism, or the alternative to capitalism, naturally, Marxism is the main thing. And in many countries now, the people started once again going back to refer to Marxism. What will be the solution and all this? This is one part. From country to country, it makes a difference. It is not only the question of general theory. Practically, in many countries in Europe, there is a terrific problem for the people of unemployment, price rise, inflation. People are coming in streets in millions in fighting against the so-called solutions of the European Union on the name of austerity and all that. The whole burden of the crisis is being thrown on the common and middle class people, on the employees. Their real wages are being cut. Unemployment is growing abnormally. The health insurance is cut. Pensions are cut. In these circumstances, what is the so-called additional austerity measures which they are going to take? Recently, the report of Joseph Stiglitz and Amartya Sen and others to Sarkozy, the president who was deposed last week in France, has given an excellent report about the GDP, about the GDP and its relation with the standard of the living of the people. They said the GDP is in no way can be a sort of an instrument that can determine decide the standard of the living of the people. They said the inequalities in the world, that is creating the biggest problem. The gap between the rich and poor is increasing. This is what we, the Marxists, were telling all these years. According to the World Global Reports given by Credit Suisse, the biggest Swiss bank, almost 15 days back, they said there is enough wealth in the world that can solve the problems of the entire people in the world. According to them, it will come distributed among the adults in the world, 440 crores adults. It will be something like 22 lakh rupees. But the problem is it is not in the hands of the governments to distribute. It is in the hands of the few corporate houses. And these corporate houses are trying to throw the entire burden on the common people and trying to reduce their standard of living, deny them the basic facilities and all that. So naturally, these slogans like 1:99, these type of things are coming up. Whose slogans are these? These are not the slogans of capitalism. These are the slogans of the people who think the capitalist exploitation should go. So these are the slogans inspired by the Marxists, by the communists. And we are very confident that in the coming period, the only alternative, the meaningful alternative for the present crisis can be presented by the socialist communists than the capitalist one.
Okay, excellent, sir. Sir, next I would like to ask Dr. J.P. Garu. There are about, I think this is most popular question. So the question, similar questions from Rakesh, Hyderabad, Vishnu, Kamisetti, Livermore, California, S.S.P. Rao from Andhra Pradesh, and Arvind from Bridgewater, New Jersey. So they were all asking about So the LSP and CPI or CPM, so the economic policies or vision for development are different from LSP. And so how is, so you have the alliance with CPM and you are working on a few issues with CPI. So how is this alliance going to work? And if this is a purely a political move, or and they're also asking about the upcoming 2014 elections, whether there will be any common manifesto. If so, how will, because there are disagreements about FDI, free markets, and minority reservations, jobs, etc. So they would like to know how the whether the working together now or potentially an alliance in 2014 will work.
It's a great question. You know, for two people or two groups to come together to work for the common cause, we don't have to necessarily agree on everything. I don't think any two intelligent human beings will agree on everything, even a wife and husband or two brothers or two sisters. First, you must recognize that. When the broader purpose is the same, there's no reason why we should not be willing to work together, setting aside some differences. For instance, take the question that Sudhakar Reddy Garu has taken just now. Now, I may or may not agree that Marxism is alternative, but clearly, if somebody believes that in today's world that market economy and unbridled capitalism has won, that will be wrong interpretation of history. Ultimately, the Western societies, they succeeded at least in the medium term, not so much because capitalism won, but because they had the skill and the adaptation to accept those features of socialism which are sensible. Universal education, universal health care, some kind of social security, some recognition that markets, unbridled competition cannot always deliver the goods, therefore some regulation is required. All these are essentially socialist principles absorbed by the market economies, and therefore the success was not really that of the capitalism versus socialism, but it's really an adaptation of the best socialist principles into competition and choice and individual liberty and rule of law in the market economy. If we view everything as black and white, oftentimes I think history proves us wrong. If you take the specific context in which Lok Sabha is willing to work with the two communist parties in Andhra Pradesh and across the country, the biggest challenge today is how to make ethical politics sustainable. After all, all of us are saying is so eminently sensible that in any rational society, it must become the dominant feature of politics. We can then fight on specific policies, but there's no fighting on policies. Today, the only politics that is working, that is succeeding, is unethical politics, corrupt politics, vote-buying politics, politics of division, politics of freebies. And there are objective reasons why it is happening this way. Unless we bring ethical politics to the fore, and unless we come up with a coherent agenda based on education, healthcare, genuine strategy to eliminate poverty, rule of law, fight against corruption, regulation and control of liquor so that the poor are protected, and a whole lot of other issues on which the communists and Lok Sabha are totally united, local government, empowering local government, empowering citizens, these are all issues on which there is absolutely no disagreement. We often tend to exaggerate the differences and forget the unifying principles. We must shed the narcissism of small differences if we really want to make a difference to the country. In the context of Andhra Pradesh right now, the people seem to be rejecting both the status quoist traditional parties, which have been at the helm for quite some time. But they're not really finding a better alternative. They're lashing out and finding a third alternative, which seems to be steeped in the same tradition, same ideology, which is actually the illegitimate child of the same illegitimate politics. So unless people are shown another refreshing alternative, a new way of doing politics, clean politics, ethical politics, with a coherent agenda, it will be difficult for us to get a better society out of the present confusion and flux. And our belief is that the ethical forces in politics are out of it. Individuals, groups, and political parties, they come together with a coherent agenda, set aside their differences, I believe that there is enough of an agenda, enough of a framework to provide the people a viable alternative to give them the trust and confidence. And at the national level, unless we change the electoral system, if we continue with the same electoral system of first past the post, with the importance of marginal vote, therefore vote buying, divisive politics and freebies as the defining principles of politics and elections, I'm afraid Indian transition will take a long, long, long time. India will improve, but it will take 100, 150 years. But that's not the kind of time that India has. We are in a very rapid phase of history. Unless we quickly change the nature of politics, also the incentives, through some form of proportional representation or some other political reform of that kind, so that better politics, clean politics can be viable, ethical politics can be sustainable, the country is in mortal danger. And for that, again, the people who care deeply enough and who have enough thinking into these issues, they must come together and work together. We believe very, very firmly that India has achieved quite a great deal. Earlier a question was asked about the five people dying in police action or not. That's not important how many people died. What's important is that India accomplished some miraculous changes as a democracy. One of them is integration of states, federalism, sustaining and protecting liberties, ensuring political competition, ensuring at least moderate economic growth, even as liberty is preserved. All these are remarkable achievements, a constitution and the institutions of constitution. But unfortunately, we are not showing the kind of energy, the kind of passion, the kind of ability and leadership required to now confront the challenges that India faces. For that, unless politics takes a different kind of shape, unless ethical politics is brought back to the mainstream, we have a problem. And for that, I believe all the decent elements, sane elements, people and political parties have been fighting against very heavy odds, with very deep ethical roots, with deep concern for the country. We all must come together, submit some minor differences, and work for the bigger cause. And therefore, we believe that in Andhra Pradesh, there is a realistic opportunity to create that framework. But political parties have their own imperatives in the short term and medium term. While we work on issues, political alliances, it depends on the party's current situation, their strategic and tactical moves. But we do believe that the Communist parties and Lok Sabha will be able to work together to try and provide an alternative in Andhra Pradesh and to build a coherent agenda, and most important, to try and work for an alternative political electoral system which is cleaner, which brings the best people into leadership, which changes the nature and tenor of politics in India. And that's our hope, and that's what we are striving for.
Okay, thank you, sir. We have a caller, he's Srikanth from Los Angeles. He would like to ask a question. Srikanth Garu, please go ahead.
This question is for Sudhakar Reddy Garu. Sir Sudhakar Reddy Garu, we had a great opportunity earlier to listen to Narayan Garu from CPI on NRI Samay, and he enlightened all the listeners that CPI has been relentlessly pursuing, and as such, they are the first to put in the women's reservation bill in place in the parliament. And he mentioned that a few women from CPI party have drafted that bill as well. So my question is, so where does this women's reservation bill stand? Is it needed or necessary? And is CPI party pursuing it further? And my question to Dr. JP is, Dr. JP, is women's reservation bill a necessary component to pull up the spirit of women whose representation in electoral process is very limited? Thank you.
Okay, first I would like to ask, request Sudhakar Garu to respond, and then I will give it to Dr. JP Garu.
So, women's reservation thing is more or less now all the political parties in principle agreed. It is whether it is necessary or not, it is out of question now. They are part of our society. They are being denied. They are being discriminated. And though some opportunities are provided in the employment and education, in some rights, in the property, all these things, political empowerment of women is one of the essential parts of the successful democracy in our country. They have got every right to be part of our democratic process. But some political parties are creating problem, creating some hurdles, and they want to link it with some other type of reservations, like caste reservations and all that. We don't agree with this. But unfortunately, the ruling party, which has to fight, which has got the support of the majority of the MPs and majority of the parties, is trying to dodge under the name of consensus. Some issues which they do not want to solve immediately, they try to hide under the name of consensus. This is not a correct thing. It is very much essential in India to have representation, minimum 33% as such. And the panchayat level and the local board selections and all that. When the women's reservation was given, in most of the places there was a criticism that on the name of the women, their husbands, their family members are trying to rule. They are only nominal. But as a matter of fact, if you go through the details, that type of thing will be there in 5% or less than 5% places. Maybe in some feudal areas, it may be even 10%. But in 90% of the local boards, in the local self-government, women are asserting. They prove to be as equal or many places are far better than their male counterparts in administration, in solving the problems of the people in those areas. The women reservation in the legislative assemblies and parliament will go far-reaching consequences will be there to strengthen our democracy and making it more meaningful. We are for it. We will continue to strive for it.
Thank you, sir. Dr. J.P. Garu, if you can quickly respond to that, and also I'll add another question. It's Shastri from Singapore, and his question is, would not the proportionate system again bring in faction fighting and hegemony, and this might turn parliament and assembly into a caste fighting platforms and might promote irresponsible breeding among different factions? So please respond to them both.
I'll address that. First, let me take the women's reservation issue. As Sudhakar Reddy said, in a democratic society, representation legitimacy is very important. Unless all sections feel that they have a voice in legislative chambers, the democracy becomes hollow. Therefore, the principle that women should have adequate voice and representation in legislatures is absolutely unexceptionable, and most thinking Indians and most political parties agree on that. The only issue is, what is the best model? The model that is now envisaged is reservation of constituencies, which necessarily entails rotation of constituencies. And what happens with reservation for women is, if at least one-third is given to women, already there are 24-25% reservations for SC and ST, the total reservation will be roughly half the constituencies. Now, if you also go in for rotation for, let us say, SC constituencies, but not ST, nearly 90% of the constituencies will be rotated every time. Even if it's only women's constituencies that are rotated, the one-third women seats become open next time, and one-third open seats earlier will become women's seats this time. That means at least two-thirds of the seats will be rotated in each election. Now, what does that mean? That means that there is no natural way of leadership rising. If a woman becomes a successful leader, is respected, it's very difficult for her to retain the seat next time along, because after reservation, the men will not allow her to easily succeed. If a man succeeds in becoming an influential leader, a respected leader, a competent leader in a constituency, he will not have a chance next time. This makes politics more like a lottery. There is a more elegant way of reserving seats for women and other sections. One good way would be what many European countries do. If you take Germany or many other European countries, the proportion of women or Scandinavian countries, the proportion of women in parliament is very high, sometimes up to 50% or more. But that's happened largely through the proportionality model, proportional representation model. That means without artificially foisting a woman or a man as a necessary candidate, without denying the people to vote in whatever manner they deem fit, you are still ensuring representation. Another way is recognizing that in India, the voters are not discriminating against women. This is a very important point which is missed altogether. Unlike in case of scheduled caste, etc., there is no discrimination by voters against women. In fact, the evidence over the past 60 years in India is that in general, if 10 to 11% of male candidates are getting elected in India's elections, more than 15 to 17% of the women candidates are getting elected. Among recognized party candidates, if 25% of the male candidates are getting elected in India, 32% of the women candidates are getting elected. In fact, the success rate of women candidates is higher, not lower than men. That means the voters, the electorate, the society is not discriminating against women. The parties are discriminating. Now, for the failure of the parties, you should not compel the people to only choose either man or woman in a constituency. The wise thing would be to force the political parties by law to put up, the recognized political parties, to put up the required percentage of women candidates. And that also can be done in a manner that they do not cheat. For instance, if a party which has influence in one state puts up all women candidates in other states, that becomes a fraud. We can easily separate those things. I don't want to go into technical details. We actually drafted a bill in 1998. Lok Satta, Manushi, and Lokriti, Yogendra Yadav and others, Yogendra Yadav and Manushi's Madhu Kishwar, and I, we sat, we drafted the bill, gave the reasoning and rationale, gave the data, alternative constitutional amendment and bill both were presented, and after the then election commission also endorsed it. I think we should look at options to achieve the same objective. We should not treat these things as matters of religion. We want women's representation, and we also want to make sure that the system is not sent into a tailspin. I believe it is absolutely necessary to give women adequate representation. I believe that there are ways of doing it in a manner that is politically acceptable and rational that promotes leadership development. As far as the proportional representation and the risk of casteism is concerned, undoubtedly there is always a problem. No political system is perfect. If we think that any political system is suitable for any society at all times, in all situations, we'll be wrong. If we are in a country like Britain, for instance, where good leadership is thrown up, sound policies are there, there's a healthy debate, there's internal democracy within political parties, there's ethical politics on the whole, the best and the brightest are willing to go into political life and enrich the public life of the country, then we don't require to change the system, just because of proportionality reasons. But we are in India where money power is dominating, marginal vote is all important, freebies have become the only way of somehow enticing the vote, and divisions have become a way of creating vote banks and perpetuating their vote banks. And the best and the brightest people generally are running away from politics. Politics is reviled and completely delegitimized. Now, in this context, you have to think of a game changer, change of incentives. Two, with proportional representation, there is a risk that every small group or a caste may become a political party and have a small share of the vote and then get the seat. The answer to that is, create a threshold, let us say, 5 or 10% of the vote in a major state. In that state, you will not get either assembly or parliament seats unless you get that many votes. Now, history tells us that typically the two major parties in any state would have about 70% of the vote. And therefore, there cannot be more than one or two parties which is able to get this threshold level of requirement. So you are ensuring that there is no fragmentation of polity. Each caste does not become a political party. At the same time, you're getting a benefit that A, the good candidates can now contest and compete without having to buy the votes. B, the parties can then depend on good candidates and image and policies rather than money and vote bank politics and a few gundas and criminals or feudal laws and people with networking locally without anything else in their favor. That's the reason why 125 of the MPs in Indian Parliament are sons and daughters of earlier MPs. There's nothing else to commend them except that. Some of them probably are competent people, but their entry was essentially because of heredity or big money power. You cannot change that unless you change the rules of the game. And the voters will not think in a proportional system that the vote is wasted. They will know whether they vote for CPI or CPM or Lok Sabha or some other party. They know that if once that party crosses a threshold, their vote will be translated into seats, therefore they'll be happy to vote. Whereas right now they're always voting for the second worst candidate in order to defeat the worst candidate in their mind. They're not voting for the best candidate or party. We have to move towards voting for the best candidate or party and with healthy coalitions and a healthy debate. And finally, the good candidates will then find it easy and hospitable to come into politics. And many people are staying away from voting now, thinking that their vote doesn't matter. They realize their vote matters, they start voting more and more numbers. And that's what's happened in all proportional representation systems. Typically in a PR system, the polling percentage is 10 to 15% higher than in the first past the post system. So there are weighty reasons, but there are also risks. No system is perfect. I'm sure we can find mechanisms to see that fragmentation does not take place and healthy politics will be there, and we can have adequate checks and balances.
Okay, excellent, sir. I would like to ask one question to Sudhakar Garu. Sudhakar Garu,
yes.
Recently CPI has asked the government of India to pull out from Olympics because of the Dow sponsorship. So could you please give us a 2-minute background about what Dow has done, or Union Carbide, and also why the government of India has not taken care of the Bhopal victims, Bhopal disaster victims until now?
See, this Union Carbide, the damage they have done in Bhopal, it is one of the most shocking incidents in the recent past. Not only thousands of people were killed, several tens of thousands of people got become the victims of it in the latter period. What shocked is sometimes this type of accidents do take place in spite of all the care that is being taken. But according to the records, they were asked to change the venue of the factory from the Bhopal town to a little far off place. Somehow they manipulated. The local officer did not do it. That is why this accident has cost the lives of such a large number of people. Number two, after such a big unfortunate development, naturally they should have some moral right to compensate to the people. And the people who are responsible should be punished. They just manipulate through the bureaucrats, through the political leaders, escape from here. Some local people are giving given punishment, and that too 1 or 2 years, that is suspended punishment, who are the Indian vice presidents and all that. And people who have become victims are still not getting the minimum relief which they should get it. I was there in Bhopal only day before yesterday and yesterday. I came back only this morning. The plight is really terrible. Most of them are poor and downtrodden sections of the people. I don't know if it is any other country, there would have been much more fight on behalf of the people. But unfortunately, our government is not having any guts to fight against the American and the European monopoly companies. And that company sponsored the Olympics. Is it not a shame for the Indians to accept to be one of the participants in which they are the sponsors? Certainly we have every right to say that they should not be the sponsors. They should be brought back. They should be booked. And these people, they speak so much about the lives of the common people, about the democracy and all that. And they say that the crime which they have done in India is not a crime in the United States of America. can they do it, this type of thing happens in United States of America? Whether they will agree the same type of treatment if some other monopoly company from other country can damage and kill large number of people in that country. They are not doing it, and that government is not ready to bring the culprits to book. And it is very unfortunate that, like in the old colonial country, we are digesting all this type of nonsense that is being dictated by the neoliberal policies by neo-imperialist forces. The blood of the people will boil whenever we remember about what happened in Bhopal. No justice could be done, and no effort to get it justice. That is the most unfortunate thing.
Okay, thank you, sir. We have a caller who like to ask a question. Anant, please go ahead and ask your question. Please be specific.
Yes, please.
Dr. J.P. Garu, this question is for you. I'll make it very short. My question is a two-part question. First is, why are judicial reforms becoming a mirage in our country? And who's to police the judiciary? I mean, it's just... everybody is talking about the politicians being corrupt and all that stuff. I mean, I doubt judiciary is any better. So, I mean, judicial reforms and who's to police the judiciary?
I think it's a great question, because a democracy will not flourish unless the three key elements in that, the vote and the elections and elected governments at one apex, liberty of citizens and civil society activism and media and freedom of the press, the second one, and law and uniform application of law and rule of law as a third arm. Unless these three are equal, a democracy will not be stable and sound. Right now, certainly, there's a serious deficiency in terms of law in this country. Now, judicial reforms have been taking place to a certain extent, but not adequately. For instance, some of the procedural reforms have come into being. And a local court law actually piloted by Lok Satta. I took the opportunity in the National Advisory Council to pilot that. We drafted the bill, and we also utilized the Law Commission's Grand Nyayalaya bill. So a combination of this has become now the law in the country, though many states are not enforcing that, though it's mandatory to enforce. In India, there's always a lag between a law and its actual implementation, unfortunately. But it's a good step. But the most important thing really are about judicial accountability. If you take at the lower level, namely the subordinate courts, the Constitution provides a mechanism by which the High Court fully controls them. So the only thing is, how do you make the High Courts do the right thing? In states like Maharashtra earlier, Rajasthan, and a few other states, the High Courts acted very aggressively against corruption. High courts have adequate powers. But the real problem is the appointments and removals of judges of higher courts is horrible. And the quality of judges that go into the higher courts is less than satisfactory. Now, both these things are now thought to be addressed. Lok Satta actually invited three of the most eminent judges living in India. They're the most respected Indian judges. Justice M.N. Venkatachalaya, Justice J.S. Verma, both former Chief Justices of India of great renown and integrity, and Justice V.R. Krishna, a legendary Indian Supreme Court justice who is now in his 90s, but still active and feisty. The three of them came together, and they came up with a formula for a national judicial commission for appointments to judiciary and also for removal of the judges. In other words, instead of the present parliamentary process of removal by impeachment, which has actually failed, there's only one case recently of a Supreme Court judge where he resigned finally because of parliamentary impeachment, where we succeeded. Otherwise, parliamentary impeachment actually has become a political tool to protect the corrupt judges. Instead, if a National Judicial Commission, headed by, let's say, the Vice President, with bipartisan participation, the ruling party and opposition in equal measure, and the judges themselves being there, and jurists, if they make decisions after due process in appointment and also removal after, again, a due process. Right now, the Judges Inquiry Act is sought to be replaced by Judicial Standards and Accountability Bill in Parliament, and that's a reasonably sound bill. But it does not really take care of the constitutional issues. It only provides for a mechanism to go into inquiry against judges against whom there are allegations. That's good, but not sufficient. But after such a report is submitted by the Judicial Inquiry Committee, if the National Judicial Commission has the power to remove the judges of higher courts, then there will be adequate accountability. This, now, I'm happy to say, there is a broad consensus in the country, and the major political parties are completely in agreement. And I think in the next year or so, that will become the constitutional provision in the country, most likely. The other provision is how to get the best judges into the higher judiciary. An Indian judicial service, very much like IAS and IPS, through a nationwide competitive examination, is provided for in the Constitution, but has not been acted upon so far. Now, these three eminent judges also recommended that. That's also now making the rounds. Almost certainly, that will become a part of the Indian judicial structure, because it doesn't require a constitutional amendment. All we require is the Rajya Sabha's approval to create an All India service, and a law made to regulate their conditions of service, etc. In addition, we also have to look at judicial procedures in the higher courts and in the lower courts, because some of our laws are very dilatory. Their application is very inadequate. And I'm sure once we do that, and also we increase the number of courts, you know, there's also a problem of adequacy of judges. India has only 11 judges per million population on an average. Many other countries have about 100 judges per million population. We have a very small number of judges for an increasingly litigious society and a large population. And any society that thinks that law courts are expensive, therefore let's not have law courts, we'll have a lawless society. Therefore, we must be willing to spend some money, both for justice and police system, and make sure that they are working for the people, not against the people. Once these instruments are in place, what I suggested, and I believe they will happen, that will happen in the next few years, I believe there have been a significant judicial reform in the country. It's absolutely necessary. Many people increasingly recognize, including those in judiciary, some of the judges who articulated the need for judges themselves appointing other judges. That's what Justice J. Sorma's judgment in the Advocates on Record and Judges case is about. Even they have realized that that's a folly. You cannot trust the judges to appoint their successors. That becomes a permanent priesthood. And now there is an impressive and broad consensus across the country that we require to protect the autonomy and independence of the judiciary and at the same time make it accountable and effective. And I believe that the time is right now to bring about those changes.
Okay, excellent, sir. Next, we have a caller. His name is Shravant. Shravant, are you on the call?
My question is, hello?
Yeah, go
hello?
Ahead, Shravant.
Yeah. My question is, caste is still the biggest problem of India, and it cannot be removed, like it cannot be taken away in a few years. Why can't we make a move towards removing caste tax in names? Caste tax like Reddy, Chaudhary, Madiga, Mala, and Gaud in the names. Why can't we make it illegal? And what are the moves taken by CPI and Lok Satta party in regards to that?
Okay, I would like Sudhakar Garu, please answer the question. Thank you.
Hello. This type of the symbolic words to be kept in the name. The Communist Party, in fact, for long back has started the inter-caste marriages and removing the this type of caste symbols from the names and all that. It is a well-known fact that the Kamal Sundaraya has changed his name. But the real problem is not the changing of the caste symbolic names, but to break the caste itself. There is a very big complication on the question of the caste. Right now, on the question of the reservations and all that, suddenly some people say that now in the 21st century, what is this caste? There should be, everybody should have equal opportunity. But the people who have been denied, discriminated, their due share in education, in socio, political, commercial life. If they don't have a proper reservation for some time, it will be difficult for them to come on par with others. So for some time, it is necessary the caste census, the reservations on the name of the caste, and then we have to go to a society where we will be without the caste. It is true that in spite of all this, for example, I had a intercaste marriage. My children had intercaste marriages. But by few marriages like this, by changing some names, the caste is not going to disappear. It should be a very long battle. And before such a type of battle is to be carried out, there is a justified demand that those who are discriminated because of the caste should get their due through reservations and all that. So some sections think that the so-called elimination of the caste at this moment will be trying to do injustice to the discriminated caste. But I think that should be done simultaneously. But the caste system should go at the same time. The people who are discriminated, they are disadvantaged, they should get their due share.
Okay, thank you, sir. Dr. J.P. Garu, we have a question from Sripal Des Moines. He is asking whether Lok Satta and CPI will fight. You guys are fighting on some of the issues, agreed to fight on some of the issues. He is asking whether you both will fight together for Telangana state.
The Telangana issue has now been debated and discussed very substantially in Andhra Pradesh, across the state and Telangana region. And certain political parties have made that their sole issue, but they have no other reason that they have no other reason for existence. I don't think CPI believes that that's the single issue for the whole country. CPI believes the Telangana state should be formed in accordance with the aspirations of the people of Andhra Pradesh or people of Telangana, but they don't think that's the only issue that people should be worried about. Lok Satta believes likewise. We believe that when the people are consistently expressing their view in a democratic society, you cannot ignore that. Those aspirations must be taken into account, and an acceptable solution must be found, a comprehensive solution and a cordial solution. Duly taking into account the rights and the concerns of all the regions of Andhra Pradesh must be found. And in such a situation, Lok Satta welcomes Telangana. But beyond that, Lok Satta is not in favor of making such issues as a central piece of political action, because these are all about federalism, accommodation, and creating new federalism in a very complex society. And you must handle that with great delicacy. You must not create a situation of greater discord, but we require to create greater harmony. And we believe that Indian federalism is very strong. We have done a remarkable job in building a very strong second-tier governmental structure in this country. And I'm sure, whatever be the complexities of Telangana issue, the national political parties, because that's where the real issue is, ultimately it's the Parliament of India that has settled the issue, they have the wisdom and the experience to come together and to come up with a sensible solution that will satisfy most of the people.
Okay, thank you, sir. Next question for Sudhakar Garu. Himas from Sunnyvale, California is asking, today in India, no educated youth is showing interest in politics. No ideology is making them take active part in politics. So how are you planning to get their confidence and make them involved in politics? I think I also want to add that CPI, as a political party, there are a lot of experienced people, but not so much of youth, at least visible. So if you can answer both of these questions, that will be excellent.
First of all, I don't agree with the understanding that the educated youth are not interested in the politics. A large number of the educated people are also active and participating in the politics. There will be always a section of in the society, whether among the young or in the middle class or in the old age, who will be aloof from politics or allergic to politics and all that. That is a different thing. But what type of participation they do, that is important. The participation in the election alone is not the participation in the politics. For the social reforms, for the political reforms, in the struggle for the change of the society, all these are part of the politics of the country. Very large number of the young people are participating in this type of thing, and we want more and more young people. India is a country of the young people. Much more young people also should come and join in the active politics. There is one fact in the recent past, in the last 15, 20 years, after the liberalized economic policies, in the also very unfortunate compulsory competitiveness has come in careerism. The whole target of the life is to get into MCET, to get into medical college, engineering college, MCA, this type of things. A few of them will get it, maybe about 10% or 20%. But the other sections who try to come into this, they are getting unnecessarily frustrated, as if their whole life is ruined because they could not get into this type of colleges. It is good if they can get it. If it is not there, there are ample opportunities in the society where they can have their livelihood, where they can pursue their education and serve the society, as well as they can have an excellent careerism. During this period, particularly in the colleges, a large section of these students are alienated not only from the politics, but they are alienated from the real problems of the society. Maybe the friend who asked the question must be keeping in mind particularly this section of the society. But they also, after coming out of their education institutions, they are thinking about the present structure of the society.
Sir, are you still there?
Hello?
Yeah, okay. I have a question from Usha. She is from Hyderabad. And this question is for Dr. JP. So she is asking, what is the single biggest plank on which Lok Satta will fight the next elections? I think she is probably talking about 2014.
I believe
JP Garu, please go ahead.
There are two great challenges now in Andhra Pradesh right now, in our judgment. One is the agricultural sector and the farmers are in deep crisis. Unless the rural economy is rejuvenated and the farmers get their due, and the young people in rural India, they overcome despair and cynicism and they become confident, we have a great danger. Therefore, there are a whole lot of issues about agriculture, about urbanization, about a large number of small towns, about linking agriculture with industry, the producer with the consumer, all related to this, all those gamut of issues, which to our mind are very critical. The second, of course, is creating a regime for the future, not of the past. For instance, the electricity sector in Andhra Pradesh is now in doldrums. The power sector is in such crisis. If the current policies continue, there simply is no future left for this state. It's a disaster. Similarly, there's mismanagement of a vast number of resources, fiscally, in terms of natural resources and otherwise. So the whole resources issue, and of course, corruption. We cannot delink it from resources issue because corruption ultimately manifests in robbing the people of their resources. So these are going to be the central issues. But we're articulating for the people, obviously we have to find a language and a way of relating to the ordinary people's lives. But on a larger plane, on a philosophical plane, these are the critical issues on which we're going to fight. And when it comes to the rural living, liquor forms an important part. The government policies are so terrible that actually it's encouraging liquor consumption and destroying millions of lives. And therefore, in looking at rural India and agricultural rejuvenation and poverty eradication, liquor is going to be a critical issue. Therefore, around these issues, we are going to weave this whole political campaign in the next election.
Sudhakar Garu, are you there? He got disconnected, but he tried to call me back. I think he's... Let me try one. Hello, JP Garu?
Okay.
Sir, Sudhakar Garu, I think he dropped off. We will call him back and we will conference him.
No problem.
Sir, so next question I have is about the BT cotton and the farmers' issues. So the BT cotton, there's a debate across the farmers' community and also across the political parties whether it's helping or hurting. And I would like to ask, I think there's probably also an education part where BT cotton might help in some of the highly water available places and maybe not in across India. So can you shed some light on this one?
You know, just now, this afternoon, I participated in an award ceremony. Two agricultural scientists were given awards by the former scientists of the ICRA, Indian Council of Agricultural Research, ICAR. And there are some very eminent people, including the Director General of ICRA and others participated. I was the chief guest there. And actually, we were discussing this. You know, the key issue is not BT cotton or something else. We are trivializing issues. Unfortunately, a lot of uninformed but passionate debate is going on in the country on a variety of very complex issues. Throughout human history, mankind has genetically modified all kinds of crops. Only thing is, in those days, they did not know that they were genes. But nevertheless, they did that. Now we understand more about genes, and we have greater capacity to deal with them and to modify them. That's what we're doing. And if we reject genetic modification as a principle, as a religion, then there would be no green revolution in the world. The world would have been completely starving. Norman Borlaug and his colleagues are credited with saving 2 billion people's lives on the planet Earth. They are probably the greatest benefactors of human race ever in history because of the green revolution. Now, that's the context in which you should examine these things. As far as the specific question about BT cotton is concerned, it is best left to scientists. The scientific community across the world and in India has examined it very carefully, have taken all precautions, and then said, this is safe. And the farmers are given the freedom to choose. 97% of the farmers of India, within a few years, accepted it. India is now the second largest producer of cotton in the world. India is now the biggest exporter of cotton in the world. India produces probably the highest quality cotton in the world, and we have the potential to export vast quantities across the world as well as supplying our large domestic industry. So ultimately, leave it to the farmers. Unfortunately, in this country, we make everything into a great ideological battle because somebody in Europe made it fashionable to talk about genetic modification of foods. We think genetic modification is an issue we should be worried about. Because somebody in America does something about something else, we think that should be our battle. For instance, gay marriages. It's not an issue at all in Indian society. We import that issue. I think these cultural issues and other issues brought from other contexts to our society will be doing great disservice to ourselves. We must go by facts, evidence, logic, and ultimately the farmer's wisdom once the issue is brought to their notice. I have not seen a farmer in India who said, I don't want a better quality seed. I don't want better yields. I don't want better incomes. Farmers want better seeds, better yields, better incomes. Whatever they get, they accept it. It's for the scientific community and the regulatory agencies to ensure that there is safety involved and safeguards are available. I think endless debate on these issues which are closed is quite needless and counterproductive.
Great, sir. Sudhakar Garu, are you on the line?
Calling.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. Sorry, I think there is a technical problem in the middle. So we have a question from Pradeep Garu. He is asking, because CPI is against nuclear power policy and voted against it in 2008. So what are the alternatives that CPI is proposing, especially because the demand for the power has been increasing? If you could tell us in 2 minutes, then we will I'll ask the last question and I will wrap it up.
As far as the power projects and other things are concerned, we are for production of the power in our country to fully utilize the hydroelectric, thermoelectric and other projects. Right now, we are fully supporting the renewable energy, wind and solar energy, though it is little costly. What we were afraid is, it is not the question of say, electricity project that was being brought from ESA, but it is a military strategic alliance that is being brought along with it. These conditionalities, that is not really good. They did not reply why for the last 2 decades in the United States of America, no new nuclear plant is being constructed. They are trying to sell the left-off reactors and all these things to India and then to drag India into that strategic partnership with them. That is one which we opposed. But at the same time, we would like to have power projects from any country, including the USA, but without the strings, without the conditionalities. They are not just giving it free of cost. We are paying very high cost, and while paying all this amount, they should not try to force us the things which we doesn't need. After Fukushima accident in Japan, many countries in the world, particularly in Europe, are rethinking about the nuclear plants. We are not totally opposing about the nuclear plants, but the time has come that we should review very carefully about the safety and security from the nuclear plants. So we can take a decision later, particularly it is not the layman or the political leaders alone who can take the final decision about it. The experts from this field, not the experts that have been manipulated by the United States of America or the people who just say what the government of India wants to say to the people, but the real impartial experts, they should all sit down, discuss, and then give a proper advice to the parliament where we have to decide. This is what we
do. Okay, excellent, sir. We have 2 minutes before the show will end. I would like to ask the last question. This is from Karthik Vinay, IIT Kharagpur. The question is for Dr. JP. So, Dr. JP Garu, do you think we'll see a common agenda by Lok Satta and CPI and CPM for 2014 elections?
It's impossible to to predict. We are not astrologers. But I believe that there is a real commonality of approach in many issues. I believe that what Andhra Pradesh today needs, for instance, is local government, fight against corruption, control of liquor, fairness and justice to the New Deal for agriculture and rural rejuvenation, sensible urban management, sensible management of power sector, and ethical politics. On almost all these issues, there is a common approach between the left and Lok Sabha. And I believe this is an adequate ground at this point of time, given the complexity of our situation in the country in Andhra Pradesh, for parties to come together and to fight for that. Now, whether these parties will be able to come together or not depends on a variety of factors. No, ultimately, their analysis of the circumstances in the state, their own political advantage or disadvantage in the short term, you cannot ignore that altogether. The way the cadres of the political parties respond to any decisions or any thinking that the senior leadership may have, all these are important factors, because political parties by definition are organic creatures, democratic in spirit, and you cannot simply dictate to the cadres what you want to do. I hope that all of us together will have the energy and the sankalp, the desire to really bring ethical politics to the fore and give a new direction to the Andhra Pradesh politics. Otherwise, I'm afraid in the short and medium term, the state is in for very, very turbulent times, and probably there will be a lot of suffering, needless suffering, for a large number of young people of this generation. But let's hope that together we can ward it off.
Okay, excellent, sir. I would like to ask, so we have a few more minutes, and I apologize that we took more time from you than what we told. We told 1 hour, but it obviously has been more time. I would like to ask Sudhakar Garu to maybe in a very short message to our listeners who are mostly Indians and across the world, including Indians in India.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Please.
I am extremely happy to participate in this type of interaction where we could exchange our ideas. And I believe more such interactions will bring us more closer and nearer. As I understand, many of the young people who are in far-off countries, they are really interested in the history of our country. Hello?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
And I believe that they should continue their efforts in this. And there are lots of young people here in our country also who are interested in changing the society better for the citizens of this country. Let us all together continue our fights for a change, a better change, for a corruption-free, better India in the future. Thank you.
Excellent, sir. I would like to thank both of you for coming onto the show, and you guys have a great night. Thanks to all our listeners. If you have missed the show, please listen it on YouTube.
Thank you, Sri Garu.
Thank you.
Wish you all the best and good night.
Good night, sir.
Friends, that is the today's show with live with Dr. Jayaprakash Narayan and Suravaram Sudhakar Reddy Garu from CPI. I hope we tried picking up as many questions as possible from the NRSMI live chat, and as well we have picked up questions from Facebook chat as well. We have, if you have more to ask, please do send us an email to nrsmi@gmail.com. So, friends, I hope you had a wonderful show today. So, if you want to listen to the show, please do visit us on youtube.com/NRI Samai. And also, we can also stay tuned to NRI Samai weekend after weekend. We try to bring in the best shows as possible. So, tomorrow we have a wonderful show with about gender equality with Kamyani Mahabal. So please do tune in tomorrow, the same time, 9 a.m. Pacific time, 11 a.m. Central time, 12 p.m. Eastern time, and 9:30 p.m. India time. Thank you, friends. Thank you for tuning in today. Thank you very much. Listen to this wonderful song, and we'll wrap up the show. Thank you, friends, for tuning in today. You can check back this show, the recorded version of this show, in another 45 minutes to 1 hour time. So keep tuning in to NRI Samai. So you can listen to all our shows at youtube.com/NRI Samai. That's it for today. Thank you very much for tuning in. Wherever you are around the world, thank you very much. Bye.